بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهد الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، إخوتي في الله، أخواتي في الله، اعلموا أن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، كل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters, inshallah, you can see the place is a little bit tight, so if you can squeeze yourself, especially maybe to that side, so our brothers who are coming late, they can have space to be part of the masjid بإذن الله. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ فَفْسَحُوا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks you to make space for each other, then make space for each other. So inshallah, we have some spaces here and we have some spaces there. And our brothers who come in late, inshallah, they may be able to participate in this talk or be part of the talk inside of the masjid bi'idni subhanahu wa ta'ala. Certainly, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we want to reflect on the life of the Messenger of the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we want to know what made them so successful. And why the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam today, we are not as successful as they used to be perhaps. If we follow their footsteps, if we do what they did, if we live Islam like they lived perhaps, we can succeed as they succeed, rahimahum radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. And when I read, I reflected on the seerah of the Nabi, of the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I realized they did many great things. But perhaps today we can cover three things that they did radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. And by doing these three things, we can achieve what they achieved radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. And remember the statement of Imam Malik rahimahullah, when he said, the condition of this ummah will not change except until we bring what changed the first generation. What made them successful is what we need today, rahimahullah, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. When we read the seerah of the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we realize they had three qualities, or they have many qualities, but the first of the three qualities I would like to mention is that the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they considered this deen their responsibility as individuals. They considered the responsibility of this deen their own responsibility. Where we as Muslims nowadays, we always like to push that responsibility onto someone else. We say King so-and-so is not doing his responsibility. That's why the enemies of Islam are taking advantage of Islam. The wealthy people of the Ummah, they're not doing their share. Therefore, the needy Muslims, they are in that situation. That's why our masajids are like this. That's why our poor people are living in this condition. And we always like to push the responsibility on others. We always say, ikhwati fillah, it is someone else's responsibility to change the condition of the Muslim and the Islam. But the Sahaba, their attitude was completely different. Their attitude was, it is my responsibility. لا تكلف إلا نفس. They were only following that I am responsible of me, and my responsibility is the responsibility that will change the condition of the Muslim. ولا تزر وازرة وزر أخرى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, no one else will carry the burden or the responsibility of others. No one else except that person, except you, except you, except her, except that person. It is us who are responsible. And when we look at the responsibility of the Sahaba and how they react to this, the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we take examples from them for their lives. Once, and I think this was the form, the ma'raka of the Salasil or Riqa', one of them. The Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were coming back. And then when they were all coming back from fi sabilillah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba, who is going to be in charge guarding us tonight? So two Sahaba from the Sahaba of Rasulullah, they took the responsibility among themselves, upon themselves. And they said, us, O Messenger of Allah. And this was Ubayd bin Bish and Ammar bin Yasir radiallahu anhum ajma'in. And these two companions, brothers and sisters in Islam, Messenger of Allah made them brothers in the covenant that they had among themselves. So Ammar bin Yasir and Ubayd bin Bish, Ubayd said, أَتَنَامُ أَوَّلَ اللَّيْ أَمْ أَخِرَ. He said, you're going to sleep, you're going to take the first turn of the night, or you're going to take the later part of the night, which is the last part of the night. Are you going to sleep first, or should I sleep first? Then Ammar bin Yasir said, no. You go and sleep first. Radiallahu anhu. Ammar bin Yasir said, now I am going to sleep first. You're going to be in charge of the guarding the Muslims and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first part. So Ammar bin Yasir, he slept. Ubayd bin Bish, he looked around radiallahu anhu and he checked and he realized there is no enemy the way he can see. And then he said, Allahu Akbar. And he stood up for Qiyam al-Layl. And he started reciting Surah Al-Kahf. Surah Alhamdulillah, الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب. And then he started enjoying the sweetness of the Quran. But he did not realize was, there was this A'rabi, an enemy, who was walking behind the army of the Muslims. And he looked and he realized that someone at the guard, someone standing there to guard the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to guard the Messenger of Allah. So he watched him and he waited. And then he took an arrow and he put on a bow and he hit him. Ubayd bin Bishr, he took it out of his body and he put it aside. And the blood started gushing from him. And then the same thing the Arabi did three times in a row. Finally, Ubayd bin Bish, he woke Ammar bin Yasir. And he said, I'm hit. And when that man, the Arabi, when he saw someone else is moving, he ran away. So Ammar bin Yasir said, Rahimakallah. Why didn't he wake me for the first time? He said, Wallahi, I was enjoying the sweetness of the Quran. And I didn't want to cut the Qur'an, the recitation of the Qur'an. The only reason I did it now is because I remember that if enemies of Allah, the enemy of Allah, reached the Sahaba, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I would be responsible of it.
and it is my responsibility to guard them. That's the only reason I start. That's the only reason. Not because he didn't say, well, Ammar ibn Iyas is right here. This is his responsibility. No, I'm going to enjoy this until I die and become shaheed. He said, no, I would die if he said he did that, but I did it because I realize it is my responsibility to protect the Muslims and to protect the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because of such attitude, they were able to carry the banner of Islam on their shoulders. Because each one of them said, it is I who is responsible for Islam. Umar bin Khattab radiyallahu anhu, he gathered the Sahaba in the Masjid, Masjid al-Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَالَ تَمَنَّوْا He said, each one of you, tell me your wish. What would you like? تَمَنَّوْا And Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu, he said, يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَتَمَنَّا الضَّرْبُ بِالسَّيْفِ وَالصَّوْمُ بِالصَّيْفِ وَإِكْرَامُ الضَّيْفِ He said, I wish for three things, يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ I wish for three things. الضَّرْبُ بِالسَّيْفِ To go up فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَالصَّوْمُ بِالصَّيْفِ And to fast during the hot summer days. وَإِكْرَامُ الضَّيْفِ And to honor my guests. I have three wishes, O Amir al-Mu'mineen. Then Khalid bin Walid, he said, it's my turn, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. أَتَمَنَّ He said, I wish if the night was cold and dark. And I cannot see my enemy. And I fight fi sabilillah until I die. Then Umar bin Khattab, when the other Sahaba, each one of them stated their wish. Umar bin Khattab said, Wa ana atamanna, I wish if this masjid was filled with men like Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah. I wish fa astakhdimhum fi sabilillah. So I can use them to run the affairs of the Ummah. The Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ali ibn Abi Talib, two of his wish was for the sake of the Ummah. Khalid bin Walid, all his wish was for sabilillah. Umar bin Khattab, his wish was for the Ummah. But if you were there, if I was there, and someone says, what is your wish? I would say, I wish if I were rich, if I was rich. I wish if I had degrees, so I can be, you know, well known. I wish if I was a business, successful businessman. I wish if I had many children, many sons and daughters. I wish, and I would wish it would be us in my that little bubble. But the Sahaba radiallahu anhu wished for the well-being of the Sahaba, of the deen. When كما في الأثر وفي غيره when سورة الحجرات was revealed أن الله said يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا ترفعوا أصواتكم فوق صوت النبي or will you believe do not raise your voice over the voice of the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم قيس بن ثابت ثابت بن قيس I'm sorry He disappeared from the masjid. And after 3 days was from the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask about the companions. قَالَ أَيْنَهُ Where is he? One of the Ansar. He said, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, I will get him for you. So he went to his house. And then he said, مَا بِكْ قَالَ حَلِتْ I'm destroyed. He said, what did you do? He said, Amma ta'alam, don't you know I have a very loud voice? And I've been raising my voice over the voice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And my amal is doomed. And then the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the man came back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he told the man, go and tell him, that you're not amongst the people that A'man are rendered. So he came back with him And then he said, no, but anta min ahli al-jannah, you are from the people of Jannah. When the Messenger of Allah passed away, listen to this, ya ikhwati illah. When the Messenger of Allah passed away, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu became Khalifa, and the Arab, majority of the Arab, except in people of Mecca, people of Medina, people of Taif, majority of the Arab, they rejected Islam. And they said, we used to believe and follow this man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and now he's dead. We're not going to give zakah. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, وَاللَّهِ لَوْ مَنَعُونِ عِقَالًا كَانُوا يَدْفَعُونَ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ لَقَاتَلْتَهُمْ. And he said, wallahi, if they stop giving a role that they used to give to the Messenger of Allah, wallahi, I will fight them for. And then the Sahaba رضي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم went to where Musaylimah ibn Kadhdhab was. And then they were attacked. And the Sahaba at the first, they ran away. And Qais bin Thabit رضي الله عنه, he said, he went to his tent. Read his biography. He went to his tent and he took a ghusl of janazah. And then he came back to the people who were running away. فَقَالَ يَا مَعْشَرَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مَا هَكَذَا نُقَاتِلُ مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He said, not this. This is the way that we used to fight with Rasulullah صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. We were men. We were not weak people. And then he went. And he got Salim, Mawla Aba Hudayfa. And he said, لَا يَأْتِيَنَّ الْعَدُوُ مِنْ قِبَلِكُمْ. He said, do not allow the enemy to come from your side. فَقَالَ سَالِمْ بِعْسَ هَمِنْ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ إِنْ فَرَقْتُ الْيَوْمَ. He said, what a loser am I. What kind of loser am I if I run today while I'm the Habib لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ. So they stood in front of the enemy. Some of the narration, they buried half of their bodies so they won't run when the enemies were coming towards them. And both of them were killed, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. But look how he approached the situation. He said, this is not how we used to defend Islam. This is not our lifestyle. Our lives were for the Islam, fi sabilillah. And that is what is missing today, ya ikhwati fillah. Everyone else is living for him or herself, not for the deen of Islam, ya ikhwati fillah. Not for the deen of Islam. Even when they used to learn, they used to learn for the deen of Islam. Uqbah ibn Amr, when he accepted Islam, he came to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he gave him the bay'ah. He decided to go back to his sheep because he was a shepherd. And he used to say, and 12 of them, the ru'ah, 12 of them, we used to keep the sheep together. And then they decided to say, subhanallah, We gave a bay'ah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we're not learning anything from our deen. So they were smart. And they said, why don't we rotate? Each day one of us would go and learn from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Each day one of us will go and learn from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Uqbah, he said, I love my sheep. So I said to them, no, you go first. So every day one of them would go, listen to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, come back, and then teach the rest. He said, Uqba, I said to myself, what a loser, what kind of loser am I? Each one is learning from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I'm sitting here every day waiting as third person to tell me what the Messenger of Allah did. So he said, I said to my companions, you take care of the sheep. I no longer desire being part of this. And he took himself, went to the Masjid al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, became Sahib Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Rasulullah is teaching, he learns from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Rasulullah is going to somewhere else, he will go with him until he became a qari li kitabillah. And he had such a beautiful voice. Such a beautiful voice. Even after the death of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Umar ibn Khattab used to come and he used to say to him, Ya Uqba, remind us of Allah. Read from the book of Allah. And then he used to sit, radiallahu anhu, Amir al-Mu'mineen, and Uqba would be reciting Qur'an to him, and Amir al-Mu'mineen, tears would be rolling from his eyes. And he would say, Jazakallah khayra, for reminding us the days of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Until Uqba bin Amr became alim. And you know the biography of Uqba bin Amr, radiallahu anhu. He did it for Allah because he thought, the only way he can revive, the only way he can maintain this deen is being part of, take the responsibility and ownership of this deen. What else, ya ikhwati fillah? The second thing that the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had that we really don't have, and I will repeat this again and again in every majlis, that as much as I can, as long as I can do this, is the love that they have for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Love that they have. We don't love Rasulullah. I apologize if I'm offending you, but in reality we don't. Illa, except a small number of us. وَقَلِيلُنَاكُمْ And only few of us. We don't love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember what Rabi'at al-Sallam wa Aslam radiallahu anhu, when he served the Messenger of Allah and he helped him with wudu. And he served Rasulullah bringing his shoes. And Rasulullah used to reward the people who used to serve him. فَقَالَ يَا رَبِيعًا Son, what do you want? What would you like? And imagine Rasulullah is giving, telling you, I am giving you the golden opportunity. Tell me what you want and I will give it to you. If it's from this dunya and I have it, you got it. If it's from Akhirah, I will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you that. You know what that sahabi said? He said, Ya Rasulullah, as'aluka murafaqataka fil jannah. I want to be your companion in Jannah. I don't want to be with Abu Bakr. I don't want to be with Umar. I don't want to be with anyone else. I don't want to be in Jannah by myself. I want to be with you. I want to be your companion in Jannah. فَقَالَ أَوَ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ Do you want something else? Would you like something else? قَالَ هُوَ ذَلِكَ That's what I want. Then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam قال أَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ Help me with yourself performing a lot of sujoods. Doing a lot of sujood. You want to be with me? You want to be from the people of Jannah? No. You want to be in Firdausa? No. You want to be with me? Yes. This is what I call ulub al-himma. They aim the highest spot in Jannah. And the Messenger of Allah said, help me with yourself and you will be with us. When Sa'd bin Rabi' in the Battle of Uhud, Sa'd bin Rabi' was hit. Oh, I'm sorry, was part of that. The people of the Muhajirin and the Ansar who came to Afid in the Battle of Uhud. And Sa'd is a Sahabi, Sa'd bin Rabi' is the brother of Abdul Rahman bin Auf in the Hadith, we all know the Hadith, very famous when he said, you know, I have two wives and I have two gardens, you take one of my wives, marry. We know the Hadith, but we don't know how that man, radiallahu anhu, died. Most of us don't know. Sa'd bin Rabi' at the end of the Battle of Uhud, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قَالَ مَنْ يَأْتِنِ بِخَبَرِ سَعَدْ Who's going to tell me about Sa'd bin Rabi'? Sa'd bin Rabi' فَقَامَ سَيْفِ الْثَابِدْ فَقَالَ أَنَا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ I will tell you where he is and what happened to him. Zayd bin Thabit, he went and he asked, around, what happened to Sa'd bin Rabi'? No one can tell him anything. And he raised his voice, وَقَالَ يَا سَعَدْ يَا سَعَدْ بِن رَبِيعٍ يَا سَعَدْ بِن رَبِيعٍ No response. فَقَالَ زَيْدْ بِن ثَابِتْ قُلْتُ فِي نَفْسِي إِن كَانَ بِهِ رَمَقٍ If this man is alive, then he will respond to this call. فَقَالَ يَا سَعَدْ Inna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yas'alu an. Rasulullah is asking about you. Faqala in a very weak voice, Ha ana, I'm here. He said, Zayd bin Thabit, I turn and realize the man is in a pool of his own blood and he's about to die. And I went to him, radiallahu anhu, and went down on my knees. And I said to him, Ya Sa'ad, Inna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqra'u alayka salam. He's giving you his salam and wa yaqulu lak, Hal wajadta ma wa'adaka Allah? Did you find what Allah promised you? And then Sa'ad bin Rabi' radiallahu anhu, he responded back and he said, Alayka wa ala Rasulillah salam. And then he said, Qul li Rasulillah, yes, I found what you promised us. And then he said, وَقُلْ لِلْأَنصَارِ And tell the Ansar, لَا حُجَّةَ لَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ There is no excuse in the sight of Allah on the day of يوم القيامة. If the messenger of Allah is hurt or harmed, وَفِيكُمْ عَيْنُ تَدْرِيشٍ And one of you can put an eye. You have no excuse in the sight of Allah. You have no excuse in the sight of Allah if anyone harms Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and there's one of you still alive. One of you. Subhanallah. Not just your men and your no. Any Ansari is still alive and things get to Rasulullah, you have no excuse in the sight of Allah. See, that's how they live, how they love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. None like us. We say we love Rasulullah, but wallahi, innaha, it is lip service. We say we love Rasulullah, but it's not what it is. So the day that love that we have for Rasulullah becomes a reality, and we live our life according to how he lived, and what he loved, and what he desired, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we're not going to change. We will not change, and I promise you, because this is the fact. The day we make a turn, and we say we love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everything that we do is based on Rasulullah, wallahi, that is the day that our lives will change. And the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the Ma'arif al-Qadisiyya, ikhwati fillah, Amr ibn Hisham, I'm sorry, Al-Harith bin Hisham, the first man who narrated the first hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, Hadith Aisha. The first man who asked the first hadith, the man who asked the Messenger of Allah, how is the revelation was revealed to you? That man who accepted Islam the day of Fath Mecca, he took his nephew Ikrimah bin Abi Jahl. When both of them became a Muslim, he said to his nephew, we've been fighting Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Islam. Today, we give promise to Allah in front of the Kaaba that we will give our lives for the deen of Allah and for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then in that battlefield, the morning of that day, Ikrim radiallahu anhu comes to the Sahaba and the army of the Muslims. And he said, last night Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to my dream. فَقَالَ يَا إِكْرِمَةَ Or إِكْرِمَةَ How would you like to break your fast with us today? And the Sahaba and the people who were there, the Mujahideen, and they said to him, وَمَا تَأْوِيلُ How did you interpret the dream? And then without saying anything, he went back to his tent. And then he came back all wet, wearing his cup, his shrouds. And he said, the dream is, the interpretation of the dream is, I will be dying today. Ya ma'ashir al-ansar, ya ma'ashir al-muhajireen, what would you like me to tell the messenger of Allah if I meet him? If our souls are the souls of the mu'mineen, they meet. And the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cried, and they said to him, tell him our greetings, give him our greetings, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and tell him we missed him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We missed the Messenger of Allah. And shortly after that, Ikrimah was hit, and Harith was hit, and other, according to different narration, 3 to 5 other Sahabi people were hit. And then Khalid bin Walid comes, ya ikhwati fillah, with drink. And he comes to Al-Harith bin Hisham. Al-Harith bin Hisham is the brother of Abu Jahl. Al-Harith bin Hisham, and he says to him, drink. And Harith looks to Ikrimah, and he says, no, give my nephew the wine. And then he gives to Ikrimah, and Ikrimah looks to another Muslim brother, and tell all of them, 5 to 7 of them, keep saying the same thing, give it to my brother, give it to my brother, until Khalid bin Walid came back to Al-Harith bin Hisham, and then he realized Harith is dead. And he went to Ikrimah, Ikrimah is dead. And he went to every other injured Muslim, and they're all dead. And then Khalid bin Walid, he threw the water, and he looked up, and he said, Ya Allah, asqihim min salsabil, فَإِنَّهُمْ خَرَجُوا فِي سَبِيلِ. Ya Allah, and let them drink from as-salsabil. Indeed, they gave their lives for your sake and for the sake of Allah, for the sake of the deen. Until we become that person, those individuals who are giving up or leaving our desires for the ummah or for the others, wallahi, the condition of the ummah will not change. Third is al-infaq fi sabilillah. Al-infaq, giving fi sabilillah. And this is something that the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they gave everything fi sabilillah. Everything. Imagine, ya ikhwati fillah. Imagine Suhayb bin Sinan bin Malik bin Amr bin Aqim bin Amir النمري الرومي البدري المهاجري رحمه رضي الله عنه صهيب الروم. This man, when he was leaving the city of Mecca, and Quraysh chased him, they chased him, and then when he realized that he can never run away from them, he turned and he said, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh, you know inni armakum, you know my head or my arrows will not miss you. And wallahi, I will not miss any one of you. And when you get to me, I will fight you with my sword. And one of them said, wallahi, we will not let you leave with your wealth and your soul. And he said, if I give you my money, will you let me go? They said, yes. And he told them when he hid his wealth. And when he reached the city of Medina, the Messenger of Allah, كما في قال, رَجِحَ الْبَيْعِ يَا أَبَا يَحْيَا رَجِحَ الْبَيْعِ يَا أَبَا يَحْيَا. Oh, Abu Yahya, what a successful transaction. What a successful transaction. He gave his wealth في سبيل الله, so he can practice this deen في سبيل الله. And as Allah, you can take your children for shopping, for Eid shopping, and spend the best that you have. Buy them the best that you can afford. But when it comes to fi masafi sabilillah, for the masjid, for the Quran school, we are very tight. Very tight. And wallahi, until we learn to give. Come up with qissat Abu Dujana. And you know the qissat Abu Dujana. Until you give the best that you have, you will not achieve that level. And the qisat for those of you, qisat Abu Dujana rahimahullah radiyallahu anhu. The mu'arrikhin, they said one of the Ansar lost his father. And this young boy, you know, when you're a teen, you want to protect, you're the man of the house. You're the man who's watching, who's looking after the affairs of the house. And this little boy, you know, he realized the only way he can protect, or he assumed, to protect his father's property is to put a wall around his farm. But he realized that also there's a tree that is leaning towards his farm, but the tree is located on his neighbor's farm. So he comes to him and he said, "Ya Ammah, give me that palm tree. Just a tree, give it to me so I can add the wall around it." He said, "No. It is one of the trees that bears a lot of fruits, and I take care of my family because of that." And then he said, "Well, sell it to me." And he said, "No, I can't. I won't." So the boy said, "Wallahi la'arfa'a amraka ya Rasulillah. I will take this matter to the Messenger of Allah." And the man said, "For what? For my own property?" So this young man, he went to Rasulullah. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, my neighbor from the Ansar is not willing to give or sell that palm tree to me." So when the man came to the masjid, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam offered him an offer that he thought he cannot refuse. And he said, "Give it to him and you will get a tree in Jannah." Tree in Jannah. And the Ansari said, "No, ya Rasulullah. It's my tree, I will keep it." He said, "Well, sell it to him." He said, "No, I will not sell it to him." So the man, he just got up. Abu Dujana, rahimahullah, radiyallahu anhu. Abu Dahdah was standing next to him. فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, "Can I get the same offer if I give him that tree?" فَقَالَ هُوَ لَكَ يَا رَسُولَ أَبَا دَحْدَى. In another narration, they said he went after the man. فَقَالَ يَا فُلَانَ, "أَتَعْلِمُ بُسْتَانِي, do you know my farm such and such?" And this, the farm of Abu Dahdah was well known. And he said, "وَمَنْ لَا يَعْرِفَ, who doesn't know it?" فَقَالَ هِيَ لَكَ بِتِلْكَ الشَّجَرَةِ, it is yours for that tree. قَالَ أَتَضْحَكُ أَتَسْتَهْزِئُ بِي, قَالَ لَا, and these guys are shuhud. He said, "خُذْهَا فَلَا خَيْرَ فِي شَجَرَةِ أَوْ فِي نَخْلَةِ فِي يَا رَسُولِ اللَّهِ." There's no khayr in that tree when someone took the matter of that tree to the Messenger of Allah. "I don't want it, you take it, I'll take your farm." And his farm, they said it had over 400 trees. And then Abu Dahdah came to Rasul, فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, "Can I get the same deal of them if I get him that tree?" فَقَالَ هُوَ لَكَ يَا أَبَا دَحْدَاهُ, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, the tree is for the yateen. The tree is for the yateen." And then he went to his wife and he stood outside the farm. فَقَالَ يَا أُمَّ الدَّحْدَاهُ, "يَا أُمَّ الدَّحْدَاهُ, قَالَتْ لَبَيْكَ يَا أَبَا دَحْدَاهُ, قَالَ خُرُجِي." He said, "Ya Umma Dahdah, get out of the farm. Get out. Bring the kids with you." قَالَتْ لِمَا, "Why?" He said, فَإِنِّي بِعْتُهَا, "I sold it to Allah and His Messenger." I sold it. And the wife went out asking, "Why? How are we going to take care of our children? How are we going to feed them?" قَالَتْ رَبِحًا بَعْيَ أَبَا دَحْدَاهُ, رَبِحًا بَعْيَ أَبَا دَحْدَاهُ. And she took the kids out of the farm. يقول والله يقول some of the مؤرخون, they said she took the days that were in the hands of her children, and she said, "We بعناها لرسول الله ولرسول," we sold it to Allah and His Messenger. We gave her up for Allah. He and his wife gave everything peacefully. But I ask you, Billah, by Allah, even when you know we've given something, do we give the best that we have? Do we sacrifice the best that we have? Do we give the most that we have? Do we even give the most that we are carrying in our pockets? Yeah. And again, until we learn to live like the Sahaba of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and learn, listen, this dunya is... A man came to the house of Abu Dharr al-Ghaffari, and he looked around, and he looked around the house of Abu Dharr. فَقَالَ يَا أَبَا دَرْ, "أَيْنَ مَتَاعُكَ, يَا أَبَا دَرْ, where is your furniture? What happened to your bed? What happened to your, you know, nice, you know, couch? What happened to your, you know, six, you know, chairs, table? What happened to your nice carpet? What happened to this? And then Abu Dharr, he looked at him and he said, Inna Rabba Hada Al-Bayt, Rabba Hada Al-Dar, La Yada'ana. He said, the owner of this dar, he doesn't allow us to enjoy it. He doesn't allow us to leave everything here. And then he said, فَلَا بُدَّ لَكَ مِنْ مَتَاعٍ مَا دُمْتَهَا هُنَا. He said, you must have something as long as you're here. He said, no. دَارِ وَمَتَاعِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. He said, my dar, my stuff, my belongings, everything is in Jannah. Look at that, how intelligent that Sahabi. He gets something, he deposits in the account of Akhir. Us, when we get money, when you get $1,000, when you get, if you don't spend it right away, you deposit in your account so you can save. You can save. Because our account is based in this dunya. Their account is based in Akhir. In Akhir. يقول عبد الله بن عمر والحديث في الصحيح يقول عبد الله بن عمر I was building a house, a little house that can fit one or two. And then Rasulullah, he passed by us. And he looked at me and he was not happy. He did not give me a good look. And I realized the messenger of Allah was not happy. Me being so much engaged in this dunya. And Abdullah ibn Umar was a young man, radiallahu anhu. That man who lived 60 or 70 or 90 or, you know, and he was about to die. He was a young man. And Rasulullah did not like this for this man to be so pushed into the dunya. Three things here, ikhwah fillah. Allah, you just implement some of these three things. Some of the characteristics and the behavior and the manners of the Sahaba. If we only take this to me, we will be successful. And we can follow their footsteps and we will succeed, inshaAllah. We will stop here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. And not only some of you have been sitting here for long, we leave time for question and answer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all for listening. JazakAllah khair.
JazakAllah
khair.
InshaAllah,
we'll go
right to answer questions. Brothers, you have questions, you can just raise up your hands.
Sisters, you can write the questions.
Yeah, and sisters, you can write the questions.
You said that it's unfortunate that most of the Muslims, we don't have love for Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So, some of the things that should drive us towards being love for.
How can we love the Messenger of Allah because that love really in our lives is absent? As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Ali Imran, فَإِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ. So the best way to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to love, is to follow the deen of Allah, to follow his sunnah, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To choose him over everyone, not a sheikh, not an imam, not a madhab, not a statement of a government, not just to link yourself to. Remember hadith of the author, the incident that took place between Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu and Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. Abdullah ibn Abbas being a young man who thought he can use his logic and his interpretation. He heard the man Abu Huraira saying, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ تَوَضَّقُ مِمَّا مَسَّتِ النَّارِ. He said, I heard the Messenger of Allah saying, make wudu from the things that is being touched by flame. And this hadith is authentic hadith. This hadith is in Sunan ibn Majah, is authentic hadith that is being abrogated. Abu Huraira or Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, they didn't know that part of the hadith. And then Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, Ya Abu Huraira, أَأَتَوَضَّعُ مِنْ طَعَامٍ أَجِدُهُ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ حَلَالًا. Ya Abu Huraira, أَوَلَمْ نَتَوَضَّعُ مِنَ الْحَمِيمِ. He said, Ya Abu Huraira, should we not make, you want me to make food from food that Allah mentioned in the Quran being halal, should I not make wudu from the snow of the ice that I melted with heat? Then Abu Hurairah simply he went down and he grabbed rocks and he said to him, أقسم بهذا بعدد هذا. I swear by Allah by the number of these rocks. إني سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول توضأ مما مست النار. Make wudu from the things that's been touched by fire. يا ابن أخي إذا حدثتك عن رسول الله فلا تضل الله. And when I say رسول الله said this, سمعنا وأطعنا. Even though the hadith was abrogated by the hadith Jab. But they didn't know. So Abdullah ibn Abbas says, Sami'na wa ata'na. We hear and we know. So to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to follow him, to choose him over everyone else, to do his sunnah. Don't say it's just a sunnah, it's just a little thing. To do his sunnah. If you have miswah, it's a sunnah to do miswah before wudu and before the iqamah. Do it. Not because you need to do this. No, because it's the sunnah of Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do miswak when you enter the house, like Aisha radiallahu anha said, come if you use the Sunnah ibn Majah, Sahih al-Bani, and the Messenger of Allah used to use miswak immediately as soon as he comes home. Just do whatever the Messenger of Allah used to do. Follow his footsteps, do everything that he did, and then the love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will grow in our lives. But as long as we're just listening to the statements of the speaker, and we're reading them in this book, yet we don't apply them, that love will never come to our lives, or the love of Rasulullah will never come to our lives. Now, next up, from the sisters.
Next question.
From the brothers, yes.
Assalamu alaikum. Sheikh, I work in a condition whereby Muslims rape one another, beat one another, kill one another. What would you say about that, or what do you give to fellow Muslim brothers regarding doing that to a fellow Muslim or mistreating a fellow Muslim brother in that situation?
Now, we must, ikhwati billah, we must love one another. Because without that love, there is no deen, no jannah for us. As Allah in the Quran is stated, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ is given. The Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم قال المسلم وأخو المسلم. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم also قال لا تدخل الجنة حتى تؤمن you will not enter Jannah until you believe ولن تؤمن حتى تحابوا. And you will not become true believers until you love one another. In Sahih al-Bukhari wa Muslim, the Messenger of Allah mentioned, if two Muslims try to kill each other, both of them in Jahannam. So, ya ikhwati fillah, without loving each other for the sake of Allah, there is no Islam for us. No deen for us. Because otherwise, we are practicing the fake Islam. والشناد يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المسلم أخو المسلم لا يظلم ولا يخذل ولا يسلم. We cannot afford to do that. المسلم أخو المسلم. Not Somali أخو Somali, Yemeni أخو Yemeni, Kenyan أخو Kenyan, Sudani أخو Sudani. He said المسلم أخو المسلم. All Muslims. And until we have that, it's nothing. The day that Bilal loved Aba Ubaidah, and Aba Ubaidah loved Yasir, and Yasir loved, you know, Abu Bakr, that was the day that the Muslim and Islam became Ummah. And until we revive that, we are not doing the way we should. So for Muslims, Ya Ikhwati Bilal, instead of killing each other, we should be helping each other. We should be aiding each other. We should be concerned about one another. We should be giving whatever we have one another. We should try to aid each other, and only by then, bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we can achieve the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now,
Let's go with the question from the sisters.
The first question from the sisters is, my mother passed away about a year ago, but I recently had a dream that I was making iftar for her. What does this mean? Her mother passed away, and then she had a dream.
What we see in our sleeps are three different categories. Al-Ru'ya, Al-Hilm, Wal-Adghar. Ru'ya from Allah is good thing that you see for yourself, or mu'min sees it for you, as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated. Hilm usually from shaitan. Usually from shaitan, this is nightmares and fitting and problems, you know. You have something that evil. Adghath al-ahlam is something that you desire, then you see it for yourself. For example, you want to marry this beautiful young lady, and in a dream she comes to you, and you say, MashaAllah, I pray istikhara, and she came to my dream, therefore I should proceed and marry her. And you don't realize this was not from the istikhara, this is from your nafs. Now, if the dream is good, like the sister, what she said, then the sunnah is, if you're interpreting the dream, or if you see the dream, number one, you don't share good dream only, unless the person you're sharing has two qualities. One is a person of ilm, person of knowledge. Why? Because when the person interprets the dream would happen exactly how that dream was interpreted. Second, for you share that dream with someone that you like. Of course, if the dream is bad, we don't share that information. Now, the interpretation of the dream, I'm not the best, but Allahu A'lam, the interpretation of the dream is you should give a sadaqah for your mother. Give sadaqah on behalf of your mother. Your mother, inshallah, is in need of sadaqah, so give a sadaqah. And I think, brothers, they just told me there's a project that is this masjid, what is in undertaking. I think the sadaqah, it should be given to this masjid. Why, ya ikhwati billah? By the way, when you give a sadaqah should be, you should deal it or treat it as a business transaction. You're making business with Allah. So this business, you make the most profit out of the business. If you feed a needy person, that's a sadaqah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encouraged, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged. But the sadaqah only is for a day. But if you give sadaqah to a masjid, then this sadaqah is sadaqah jariyah. Yeah, the ajr of the sadaqah will come to your grave until the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, and as long as this masjid exists. Or you teach someone, or you bring a Quran, or you build a masjid fi sabilillah, or you dig a well fi sabilillah, or you build a house fi sabilillah. All these are called sadaqat al-jariyah. So when you're giving a sadaqah, it should be for sadaqah jariyah that would benefit the person until the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. It's not only one time thing.
Another question is, can you fast for someone who's sick or someone who is dead? Can you fast for someone who's sick or someone who is dead?
For someone who's sick, if the marad, the illness is two times, there are two times. Marad, yurja burq, illness that people are hoping to recover from. And a sickness that is permanent. For Ramadan and for Fard fasting, the person who has temporary illness, they can wait, كما قال ابن عثيمين, for other days. وَإِن كُنْتُ مَرْضَ أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٍ مِنْ. So any other days, not necessarily, in a year or two, ابن عثيمين, he said, مطلق, the door is open. For the person who has permanent illness, or the person who dies, you should pay for the person of permanent illness as long as he's alive. You should pay a sadaqah, if'amah, for every day. But for the person who passed away and he gave another, for example, then his family member can fast on his behalf, his immediate family. Now, next.
Next question is, if a man shows interest in you
and is serious enough to marry you, can you send him pictures showing your hair?
And the brother, he showed interest. And you think, you know, he wants to marry you. The question is, how do you know he's serious? The way to know that the man is serious is if he comes to your wali and he says, I'm interested in this young lady and I want to marry her. Not, you know, chatting with you on the Facebook or, you know, sending me pictures and all that and asking to, no. He should come to Biyutim in Abwabi, and she came and said, you know, I want to marry your daughter or your Mwakila or your cousin. You know, what do you think? And then the parents, all the wedding of the girl, they should, you know, create that setting for them. If this young man did not come through the wedding, I don't think that is, you know, advisable. I would not advise, just wait until he comes formally to your wali, and then we go from there, bi-idhnillah.
How important do you think soft skills are in da'wah? Like relating with the audience, having sense of humor, and narrating relevant experiences. How do you think, is it important for da'wah?
See, the best method of teaching and remembering is the method of stories and the method of questioning. That's why 70% of the Quran is qasas, stories of Bani Israel. How many times did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention the story of you, of Musa? 176 times. Story of Musa, Musa named Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. Ibrahim, I think, is 76 times. Why? Because these stories that keep coming back. Allah is telling us Musa and Fir'aun in this surah. Musa and Fir'aun in this surah. Bani Israel and Musa in this. So we can learn lessons. And each story carries lessons. So the best way of teaching people is through stories. Also through questioning. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 15 times in the Quran, if I'm not mistaken, 15 times, Allah said, يسألونك ويسألونك يسألونك. They ask you, you know. And they ask question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to question. Or the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would ask them, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ الْمُفْلِسِ. Do you know who's muflis? And then through questions, people will know. Will know, and that's the best method. Now, yes, telling people the stories, being, you know, always in that manner, it not always, but it helps. But again, the situation is what dictates what approach the speaker should take.
Next question is, can you run away from home to participate in jihad just for the sake of Allah to attain and implement the love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So is it allowed for you to run away from home to participate in jihad?
And what answer would that person is expecting? You say run away. Run away definitely shows that you're doing something not right. When you run away, you usually do something. The jihad, there is no jihad unless we have Amir that is recognized. Amir. You have to understand that. You have to have a person that we follow under. We give a bay'ah. And through that, what happened? And then you go back to the ulama, and they will tell you, especially the ulama of your country, wherever you are. They will tell you whether the jihad is jihad fard kifayah or fard ayn. Fard kifayah means they have enough fighters, so you don't need to be there. Fard ayn is they don't have anyone, and you must be there, or they don't have enough people. So the people who are there, the ulama of your country, are the people who can give you that, and also the ulama overall, Muslims, the one who can give you that. But when you say run away, automatically it shows you doing something incorrect. So I would say the best thing to do in this time nowadays and fitna that the people are going through, and you don't know who is killing who, whether you're going to kill a Muslim or you're going to kill a Muslim, the best thing to do is stay, and this is the time of fitna. This is a time of fitna. And what would you say, what would you do if you go thinking that you're doing the right thing and you kill a Muslim, wal-iyadu billah, or you did something wrong, wal-iyadu billah? When you know the story of Usama bin Zayd, when the man killed some of the Sahaba, and him and Ansari, they chased this mushrik. And then when they raised their swords, the man said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. And then Ansari, he lowered his sword. But Usama, he said, this man, he's just protecting his life, and he killed him. And then when they came back, and they were, the Messenger of Allah was told the story, he got very upset. قَالَ أَقَتَلْتَهُ بَعْدَ أَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And you kill him after he said the shahada. He said, Ya Rasulullah, he said, so he can protect himself. قَالَ أَشَقَقْتَ عَنْ صَدْرِ. Do you open his chest? How do you know? So, and Nabi saw a hadith that I mentioned earlier. Al-Qatil wal-Maqtul. If two Muslims carry weapons, both of them are in Jahannam, wal-Iyadu Billah. If two Muslims carry weapon against each other, so ya ikhwati fillah, I would say, just to avoid the fitna, this is the time of fitna, do what they did, ijtihad. Number two, why would you even go into a fitna, something that is doubtful? Stay away from it, because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قَالَ الْمُسْلِمُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُ فِي فُسْحَةِ مِنْ أَمْرِ. He said, Muslim still has chance until he put his hands on blood. Until you put your hands into that. Other thing is, who would say this person is murtad? Should I see someone say he's murtad, you know, he's worshiping the grave, or he said this, I should go? No. That is it goes back to the hakim and it goes back to the qadi. So we should not be quick on labeling people, ruling on people, doing takfir on people, judging people, because this is not our area, it's not our field. We just make dua for the people and we say, may Allah protect all the Muslims. Now.
I'm afraid of zina and I have someone to marry, but my parents are telling me to wait till I'm financially stable.
Him or her?
She is financially stable. Please, I'm afraid of zina and I have someone to marry, but my parents are telling me to wait till I'm financially stable. What should I do? Actually, it's he.
That's what I was saying. He. I was like, that's a good sister, she has money too, mashallah. Now, if you are a brother and you fear for zina, this is the time that your family, your father, your parents, their opinion has been overruled. It's overruled. If you are afraid for zina, you just go ahead and marry. As a matter of fact, here marriage becomes fard'ain on you. Fard'ain on that person. Even if the parents disagree, it's good for them to be on board and to, subhanAllah, be with the son. But if the parents are not in that mind frame and say, you know what, you know, I got married when I got a job. I got married when I was 30 years old. I got married when I was stable. Well, they don't live your life. And that's what Ali radiallahu anhu, he used to say, لَا تَقْصُرُ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَخْلَاقِكُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ خُلِقُوا لِزَمَانِ غَيْرِ زَمَانِكُمْ. He said, do not force your children to adapt your behavior. Indeed, they were created for a time different than your time. Different than yours. So as a parent, you should allow your son to marry. But if the parent says no, then the son should go ahead and marry. If he fears a zina, for instance. A man asked Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah. He said, I am a young man who's in high school, which means, you know, grade 9, grade 12, before college, university. But I'm afraid of zina. What should I do? Ibn Uthaymeen said, it is wajib ayn, fard ayn, on your father to get you married. Because you're dependent and you're under his care, it is fard'ain for your father to get your wife. And then Ibn Uthaymeen, he says, one wife is not enough, it's fard'ain to get your second wife. Wallah. And he said, if two wives are not enough, and he messed it up to four wives, right? MashaAllah. He said, it's worthy for your father to give you, and if you, your father cannot afford, it's worthy on your family members, your male family members. If they cannot, يعني your amal or their brother, you know, then you keep going until the community, all community, the masjid will say, well, this person, mashallah, three wives is not enough, let us give him four wives. That is the reason why, because zina, Allah said, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا zina. Zina is very destructive in the Muslim community. Now,
a question from the sisters. When a new baby is born, male or female, the Somali people only make adhan for the boys. What about the girls?
Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he authenticated a hadith that you make adhan in with the right ear and the iqamah on the left. Shaykh al-Albani hadith, he has the hadith authenticated, as far as I know, in two different ways. He agreed that the adhan, the iqamah is weak. The iqamah is weak, but the adhan is okay. Another authentication I found that he said even the adhan is weak. Even the adhan is weak, so you don't have to do this according. But this is for boy, for both boys and girls, not only for girls. In some of the madahib, I read that you call the adhan when the child is born, and you call the iqamah when the child dies, the janazah time. So, and he's in between, they say he's instead of salah, mashallah.
What is the ruling on the Christian universities that offer degrees? When you are joining, you are asked to sign code and conduct, of which you have to, you will abide Jesus Christ as your Lord. We're given a set of rules whereby you're supposed to sign and you have to follow Jesus Christ as your Lord. So what? These are some universities, Christian universities. So what is the ruling according to the Islam Sharia?
Number one, for you to sign that is not allowed. It's not allowed. Confirming that Jesus is the Son of God. You say you sign a contract. Even though you don't believe in that, I cannot find justification for that, period. Number two, if this is just some universities, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you other options. Go to other universities. Even if this university is the best, but signing that is not Allah, and if you live for the sake of Allah, Allah يقول وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. So leave it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I cannot find in my heart and the information that I have about Sharia, something that can justify that you sign a contract with the university saying, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God or His Lord. I cannot justify that. No.
Does fasting 6 days of Shawwal make up for my missed Siyam during the month of Ramadan? Fasting on the 6 days of Shawwal, does it make up for the days you've missed during the month of Ramadan?
The hadith, as we know, is a hadith attempting in Sunan Abi Dawud wa ghayrih. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala man sama Ramadan thumma atba'a sittan min shawwal fa ka'annama sama ad-dahr kullah. So, but the ulama rahimahumullah, they said that hadith says man sama Ramadan, whoever performs Ramadan, thumma, see, li ta'qib. He didn't say, li ta'qib. Fa, li ta'qib. بس يكون مباشر أو غير مباشر immediate. But he said ثم للتراخي, يعني he said then follows. So what they understood from this, الفهم المفهوم غير المنطوق, they said it means you finish Ramadan and then you follow with the hadith. That's what the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. So the sister should complete her whatever days that she missed, and then after that she should follow the six of Shawwal bi idnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
No. Anyone who dreams of Allah's name, what does it mean? Like if you dream of Allah's name, what does it mean?
I don't know. Next.
Can you give a copy of the Quran to the Christians, either with the Arabic font or the English?
If the Quran has Arabic and English, ulama will consider that
interpretation or translation of the Quran, they would not consider Mus'haf. They would not consider Mus'haf. So even the ulama who go with the opinion of saying you cannot touch the Mus'haf without wudu, they said this is not a Mus'haf, so you can touch it. They also said it's okay to give it to a non-Muslim because this is not the Quran. I would say the best thing to do to find a Quran, the translation of Quran in English. Because some of the non-Muslim, they stay in the bathroom very long and they have the habit of reading something in the bathrooms. And they may put a book or magazine, newspaper, and sometimes a Quran, so which is not appropriate place for the Quran to be. So I would say, inshallah, either you can give them English Quran. If that is not doable, then you tell them, these are the conditions that I can give you the interpretation of the Quran, that's Arabic writings, wallahu a'lam.
There's a lady, she's in either university or high school, but it's a body. She says, can you share your bed with a Christian lady if you are both ladies?
Sharing same bed?
Yeah, same bed.
وَإِنَّا حَدِيثَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ فَرِّقُوهُمْ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ. When they see women and men as two same genders, they can be on the same bed, but they cannot be under the same sheet. If the situation comes, they can be under the same bed, but not under the same sheet. Do you understand the difference? So they can be, like let us say two people sleeping in the same bed, there's no other space. So one they will face this way, the other will be facing the other way, but they should have their own independent blanket or bed sheet. You understand? This is when there's no fitna, but now this is a great fitna. So I would say, you know, unless there's a necessity, there's darua, I would say avoid, you know, two women being in the same bed or two people of the same gender being in the same bed together, even though they have independent sheets. Now,
is it allowed Islamically to take pictures because it seems normal in our generation? Is there any fatwa about that?
Taking pictures, Ibn Uthaymeen, then of course Sheikh bin Baz al-Albani rahimahullah, who has strong opinion against it, but Sheikh bin Baz, who said for da'wah purposes, and you know, if you have any pictures, just hide it. And you have Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, who holds the opinion that recording, you know, TVs and cameras, they're just deflecting your original image, and they're not adding anything, and they would not consider it to be taswir, so it is fine. No. And I hold that opinion, or I follow that opinion.
How can someone know when showing signs of minor shirk? How can you know that you're showing signs of minor shirk?
See, and at least in Imam Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, in his book, Jami' al-Ulum wal-Hikam, he mentioned a statement of one of the ulama, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, and he said, "Al-amalu tarku al-amali min ajli al-nasi ri'a, wal-amalu min ajli al-nasi shirk, وَالْإِخْلَاصُ أَنْ يُعَافِيكَ اللَّهُ مِنْهُمَا." He said, leaving the amal for the people. Say, if I pray very well in the masjid, people may say, look, he's doing this to show off. He said, you leaving that act is show off. That's a ri'ah. That is ri'ah. I'm sorry, he said, you, if you say, I don't want to do this, is ri'ah. He said, but if you do it for the people, oh, that's a shirk. Do you understand? If you say, I'm not going to perform my salah because I don't want anybody to speak about me, that's a ri'ah. But if you say, I'm going to perfect my salah so the people can talk about my salah, that's a shirk, he said. And the ikhlas is for Allah to save you from both of these. That's ikhlas. So when the person feels, you know, my salah at home is different than my salah at masjid, and you pray better at masjid, that's a show-off. When you say, you know, I have to move my fingers, I have to, you know, stand straight for ruku' and mashallah, my back straight for masjid, for the people, that is show-off. But at home, you just go down, up and down quickly.
The moment that you say, I'm going to recite Surah Al-Fatiha at home, but I'm going to recite Surah Al-Fatiha and Surah Al-Ikhlas at the masjid, that's a show-off. And Imam Ibn Nawawi rahimahullah, he said, Allah will reward you based on what you do when you are alone. Allah will now reward you the extra that you do at the masjid. You pray at home with Surah Al-Fatiha, and no witr, no sunnah, not before, not after, not in a long dua. You just pray Al-Fatiha, Assalamu alaikum, Assalamu alaikum, you go watch your show, or you guys, you know, go, and then you come to the masjid, mashaAllah, you tahiyat al-masjid, raka'atayn for wudu, raka'atayn before I sit down, raka'atayn before the adhan, raka'atayn after the adhan, raka'atayn, and you have 19 raka'at before the iqam, and then you do after the iqam, mashaAllah, and you go home with 25 or 27 raka'at, and you say, mashaAllah. Imam Ibn Taymi said, Imam Ibn Nawawi said, no. Allah will reward you as though you only pray the fard and you recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Nothing else. Because that's who you are. That's your reality. That is your true iman. That's your true faith. So how this is what it's so for the person to say when is when you feel you're doing something extra or you're showing up, that's when you will not know.
Inshallah, I'm over with the questions from the sisters. Would like to take questions from the brothers, please.
The other day you might have witnessed a small conference about 2 years ago about Eid. What's your opinion on how to reconcile the two parties with Eid, the other party, and try to? What's your opinion?
See, I think it's better to go back to local ulama. But I'll tell you what, we have the same thing, by the way, in Canada. See, the moon is so tricky. Sometimes the moon shows itself to a certain group and hides itself from the other group. The next day the moon shows itself to that group and the other group already finished their Eid or they start their fasting. We asked when we were together with Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, and he said, Shaykh, what do we do? Because sometimes we have 3 Eids in one city. Actually, 1 year we have 4 Eids, mashallah. And we broke the record, mashallah, tabarakallah. And Canada, we're Canada, ikhwa. We're from the first world. So the Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, he said to us, it's better for you to fast the wrong day and to do the Eid wrong day. But it's better for you to do that but united. It's better for you to be united. I'm sorry, it's better for you to be united and do the Eid and fast on the wrong day. You know this is not right. Because there's two fiqh. Ittihad al-matali' wa ikhtilaf al-matali'. Ittihad al-matali' wa ikhtilaf al-matali'. You know, so I think Ibn Uthaymeen, he said that is better for the unity of the ummah. Which I agree. So what I would say, take this issue back to the ulama, to the du'a, the shaykh of the local, in this city and other cities. My nasiha, I always say, the unity of the ummah comes first. The unity of the ummah comes first. And I'm telling you, I know the brothers, this group and that group, I know this group, they're not 100% perfect, and this group is not 100% perfect. But I think if we are united, we are in a better position. Remember when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, when Uthman ibn Affan, he traveled with the Messenger of Allah to Mecca, and the Messenger of Allah prayed Qasr. He traveled with Abu Bakr, and Abu Bakr prayed Qasr. He traveled with Umar for 12 years and 6 months, he's been praying Qasr. He traveled to Mecca, the early part, but he was praying Qasr. All of a sudden, Uthman and Aisha and others, they decided, we no longer pray Qasr in Mecca, we're going to complete the Salah. So the students, they came to Ibn Mas'ud, Abu Abdurrahman, and they said, Ya Abu Abdurrahman, Amir al-Mu'mineen Uthman bin Affan, he prayed Qasr. Ibn Mas'ud, radiyallahu anhu, qala, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And the Sahaba used to say this one, a big musibah. And then he got up and he prayed Asr four rakat. And they stood and they said, Subhanallah, istarja'ata, seconds ago, you were saying, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And you did exactly what he did. Qal, al-khilaf shar. Al-khilaf shar. To be different from one shar. You know what the Messenger of Allah said? He said, if you have one man, head of the Jama'ah, one man, and another person who is better than him 10 times comes to you and say, I want to be the Khalifa, kill that man. We don't kill him. Get rid of him. Why? Because as soon as we have firq, it's done. Umar ibn Khattab, when he was stabbed, what did he do? He appointed the head of his army to collect the 6 people that he chose. 6, all of them, Ashar of Mubashirin bil Jannah. All of them. Sa'id bin Zayd, Sa'd bin Abi Waqas, Abdurrahman bin Awf, Abu Ubaid, was it in what do you call it? Uthman bin Affan, Ali bin Abi Talib, what was it in Abu Talha? Abu Talha. No, Talha bin Ubaidillah. I'm sorry, Abu Talha. All of this one place. And he said, give them 3 days. If 4 of them come agreeing on one person and 2 of them disagree, get rid of the 2. The Amir al-Mu'mineen, you're going to kill someone who's watching the Jannah? He didn't want to kill them, but he was showing the severity of the situation. Khilaf is always evil. Khilaf, and we have a weak hadith, and then we say, Khilaf ummati, rahmah. You know, the khilaf amongst my ummah is a mercy. Ibn Shaykh al-Albani said, if that is rahmah, then ummah being united is adab. It must be adab. The unity of the ummah is adab. So, ikhwati fi Allah, al-khilaf al-shar. What I would suggest, work with whoever is in charge of this, work with him, correct him, change him. An-nas ya ikhwati fi Allah. People are nothing by their, by the product of their product. For example, when I go, if one of you, your friends, they all will tell you you're doing the right thing. But people from outside, they know you're not doing the right thing. They're not doing it. Sheikh Malik Abdullah, an incident that happened with Malik Abdullah. How many of you remember the flood that happened in Jeddah? Where a lot of people died of all the rain. Malik Abdullah, he used to think everybody in Saudi is well off. Why? Because the little bubble that he's in, they used to tell him everything is fine. When one of his close people secretly took Malik Abdullah and they took him to the street of Jeddah, he cried. He's like, I didn't know this existed. And guess what happened to that person who took him? He was done. They got rid of him. Because they said, we don't want anyone like this man to be around the king. And the people around the king, they tell him, you're doing good. Look how many mushaf you published. Look what you're doing for the Kaaba. Look how many. And they tell him, you're doing. Now, this person or this committee or this organization that in the country, any country, that live in the Muslim community, they have that little bubble around them and they think they're doing great service for the Ummah. So you guys need to be there and say, listen, this is not right. And the Muslims outside are disagreeing with you. Let's come together and change the condition of the Ummah. Work towards the unity. Work towards the unity. If you only have 2 Jama'ah in Canada, in my neighborhood, wallahi, we have 4 Jama'ahs. 4 Jama'ahs. We have Hilal Community. We have Halal Hilal. That's just Haram Hilal, mashallah. We have Halal Hilal. We have in another calculation group. We have what they call it Wahhabi group. Or, they call it, so they have different groups of each one of them. So if you have maybe 2, so inshallah, get together. May Allah bless you. Alhamdulillah. Last question. Alaykum salam.
My question goes to the issue of Isbal and the hukm of keeping the beards and shaving the beard.
Just حكم الإسباب. As we know, the messenger of Allah قال ما أسفل ما أسفل everything below the ankles are in Jahannam. عياذ بالله. And there are only there's many many ahadith. So I don't think I think everybody here knows there are 8 ahadith that 13 ahadith that I wanted to quote, but I don't want to quote too many hadith. And we follow one hadith, the hadith of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, that we're not doing because of khuyala. However, isban, which means wearing your pants below your ankles, haram in Allah, I cannot justify, even though some of the fuqaha did justify. I could not find in my heart justification for that. Beer is the same thing, the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even though this is khilaf among the scholars, he said, trim your mustache and leave the beard. Some of the ulama, they consider the fisk, because hadith Abu Hurairah and hadith Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar, both of them is saying, trim your mustache and leave your beard. But the other two sahabi also trim their beards. So Shaykh al-Bani and others, they said, well, these sahaba, who quoted the hadith, who narrated the hadith they themselves, they also trimmed the beard. So it's okay. So there are fuqaha like that. But the opinion, when you compare between the two, the opinion that's saying do not touch it, it's much better. It's much better. Allahu a'lam wa a'lam.
Jazakumullah khair. This is going to be the last question, inshallah. If your father marries another woman and isn't such a good dad anymore, can you disown
You can absolutely disown your father. You can cut him off. Don't talk to him. Don't contact him. But as soon as you do this, you just lost your akhirah. You disown your jannah. You disown your ajr. There is no khayr in your life. It's your choice. But if your father married someone else, he's still your father. Still, he was, as you said, no longer good father. So he was a good father to you once upon a time. And I most likely, you sided with your mother, and that's what happened. Your father's like, you go with your mother too. But you gotta understand the responsibility. Being sent is there. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called, رَغْمَ أَنْفَ مُرِئِنْ أَدْرَكَ أَبَوَاهُ وَلَمْ يُدْخِلَهِ الْجَنَّةِ So he said, indeed is a loser person who met his father, his parents, and they were not the reason of him entering or her entering Jannah. So no, you cannot do this. You cannot disown your father. And you cannot say, he's no longer my father. If you do this, that's it. Your akhirah is done. You should not expect any reward from Allah. And you should not expect it. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on you and forgive your parents forgive you.
What's your comment on Muslim choir groups and rappers using verses of the Quran?
They singing the Quran. With, are they using instruments or just a nasheed?
Some of them they use instruments, some via music.
A background. Nash Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he said, these nasheeds, he said, as long as the lyrics or the words are good, and as long as there is no music, then it's okay. Now something encouraging. But he also said, do not overdo it. Why? Because it will take the place of the Quran. Sometimes we have a lot of people listening to anasheed all the time, but they don't listen to the Quran enough time. So if you want to hear once a while, it's good. But it shouldn't be something like that. So now, for those people who are playing music or singing or say something negative about the Quran, they're like any other music, but any other musician, so we don't have to worry about this. I think people already missed it. We hear, you already know that it's haram and you cannot do it. For saying, little nasiha in Somali,
I believe everybody understood what I said. Somehow. Some of Somali, there's no one, he said, of Somali, I'm a Garni of Mirisa. So, of Somali, so this is what the Garani is. Although Yashmi is a Garni of Garni. So, they said, the older generation, they have more ilm than I. They know everything, Tabarakum, Tabarakum. But I will have Rallah, يعني لا سبحانه وتعالى هيدا بعنقبته. لكن نصيحة دايلو, I will give نصيحة first in English, then I'll translate in Somali. And this is the نصيحة of Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم that he gave to Muaz bin Jabal. And then I will give to the brothers who are here and also who are not here. Muaz bin Jabal رضي الله عنه نبي سعيد الخدري, they were leaving. And then the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, يَسِّرُ وَلَا تُعَسِّرُ وَبَشِّرُ يَسِّرُ وَبَشِّرُ وَلَا تُنَفِرُ وَتَطَاوَعَ وَلَا تَخْتَلِفَ. To give them three powerful nasiha, because they were going to initiate community in the middle of kuffar, in the middle of non-Muslims. So he gave them a strong nasiha. And he said, يَسِّرَ وَلَا تُعَسِّرَ. Don't make things difficult. Don't make things difficult, because sometimes people are not up to your level. And that's why Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said, "Min al-mustahabbi, tark al-mustahabbi lita'lib al-qulub." He said, it is likable to leave that which is likable to unite the heart. For example, if you come to a masjid, to a new community, and they think if you move your finger, which is a sunnah, we have six ahadith, moving your finger, if you move your finger and that you are people of the bid'ah, Ibn Taymiyyah is saying, overlook that for now. And I like how Abu Ishaq al-Huwayni, he commented on that and he said, مِنَ الْمُسْتَحَبِّ تَرْكِ الْمُسْتَحَبِّ مُؤَقَّةً لِتَأْلِيفَ الْقُلُوبِ. Temporarily. Don't leave the sunnah for good. But you leave that to unite the heart. So the messenger of Allah is saying, you know, يَسِّرَ وَلَا تُعَسِّرَ. Make things simple and easy and do not complicate things. Sometimes we want to make haram, 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 haram. I know, and I'm not asking to make which is haram, halal, ma'ad Allah. But what I'm saying, there are certain level of understanding. When the man, Arabi, came and urinated the masjid, is that halal, ya ikhwan? Is it haram? One of the brothers urinated the masjid, we're all going to beat him up. But the messenger of Allah, he said, no, no. Leave him. And later, seconds later, the man, he made dua, he said, Ya Allah, irhamni wa Muhammad wa la tarham ma'ana ahada. Ya Allah, have mercy on me and Muhammad and no one else. And he took all the Sahaba, Abu Bakr, to Jahannam. You know, because when you dealing with jihad at a different level, you need to understand, yassira wa la tu'assira. Even though he was born Muslim, yassira wa la tu'assira. And then he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa bashira, Bashira, give them glad tidings. Yani give them, it's better for you to talk about Jannah, hope, you know, what to do, instead of saying Jahannam, 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 we are destroyed, Jahannam. No. Yassira, Bashira, wa'ala, tunafir. And then the third one he said, Watatawa'a, wa'ala tahtalifa. He said, listen to each other, listen to each other, and do not differ. And when Abu Musa al-Ash'ari came back, and before he got on his horse, they saw a man that who did a had min hududillah, and then the ruling was he should be chopped off. His head should be chopped off. So he said, you know, what happened? He said, he did this. He said, I'm not getting off my horse unless you apply the hudud of Allah on this man. Imagine if Mu'adh bin Jabir said, Ya akhi, I'm in charge of this place. Just relax, get off your horse, we'll talk. No, I'm not cutting off. Then he said, okay, then. لأنه تطاوع, listen to each other, ولا تختلف. But he used the word تطاوع, which is an indication that a person of authority should not behave as such. And the person who's a lower level should not say, why are you giving me orders? تطاوع. So you listen to each other. Like I will say this in Somali, نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, سبح وانا ايوسي لبا صحابي سفر او غري يمن وضد غار احدغن وحن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يسر ولا تعسر دينك حول يري احكامك حول يري اكين بشر ذلك ابو شاريه ولا تنفر حددنينا الينا ذلك صدحا واحد من صلى الله عليه وسلم حيري تطاوع اول ستجيستا وحيث خلافنا حساب اخر ستجيستا ويسمح له وهذا يقف الله هتقول لا انا صحي انا جا صحي لما الحال اسمك لي ما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يسد النصيحه ده هيجي نسأل الله أن يجعلنا من الذين يستمعون القول فإن يتبعون أحسن وجزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
إن شاء الله, I would like to brothers, let's give some thanks to the sisters so that they can leave first, and then brothers, inshallah, later. But the brothers first, okay. The brothers will leave first, and the sisters, inshallah, later.